I'll give you a little bit of a historical rundown of actually truth and reconciliation to give you an idea of where it came from. And it didn't come from the goodwill of our federal government to do something good and to recognize the ills of the past. It came from a class action lawsuit that was filed against our federal government. And in 2007, the Truth and Reconciliation, the commission into what happened in residential schools was launched. So that's sort of the beginning of all of it. It was followed up in 2008 with an apology. So, I mean, the apology was actually well received. There were a lot of tears shed that day, hearing our federal government acknowledge what happened to all of Canada. But there was a little bit of, you know, maybe some cynicism by those of us who also understood the policies and the direction that this man was kind of leading in. And to give you a small example of that, a couple of things that happened through Truth and Reconciliation was there was a process where residential school survivors were invited to share their stories, I guess, to share their stories as a process of healing. Some could do it privately. Some were in public forums, too, all across Canada. So the public could go and actually hear these stories. A lot of tears shed during those processes as well, and it had a big impact. Another part of it was that there was settlements that were provided, financial settlements that were provided to residential school survivors, depending on how long they were in residential schools, and some other factors. But so there were some good things that were happening there, but just an example of while the one hand is doing something really, really good, shortly after that, 2009, 2010, millions of dollars in funding were being cut from grassroots organizations, from our government structures for First Nations, Métis, Inuit people, for women's groups, for youth organizations, all of those kinds of things. So I just want to provide some context to how things went down. It was not just out of goodwill. And I think some good things have come of it, but I'm just trying to give an honest representation of what has happened. And I think is continuing to happen in our country.
It was definitely done in a good way, I think, with the leadership of all of the Indigenous leaders involved in the process to do as best as they could to care for the residential school survivors who provided testimony. But that was only in the actual commission process. You know, how the program rolled out, you know, the way that compensation was determined through the court process and the compensation process for survivors. I think it was really on the survivors to have those things in place in their own life, and there really wasn't the supports. So it was very, very little supports in place, and
I don't know if you have anything to add.
Sure, I can follow that up a little bit. I mean, it's my understanding as well that there was ceremony, smudging, things involved in the process, but certainly the kinds of supports that were required for people to try to cope, you know, with this situation and their sharing and the trauma and all those wounds that were opened up, you know, en masse and communities all at the same time, we're not there to the degree that they should have been. And I think one way to look at this, in addition to like an awareness of our colonial past and present and colonization, and I think it's important we understand that this is an ongoing thing, it's not something that's over by any means, is that we also have a clash of worldviews and knowledge systems too. And that's a really important piece of all of this too, that I think the people who ran this commission did their very best to weave that in, to bring that forward. But we also need to kind of meet people where they're at a little bit, and dealing with federal structures and legal structures is only so much that can be done. And that's one thing I think I would have liked to have seen more in the calls to action itself. I know in education there were, I think, 11 calls to action in total, and within one of those, in two bullet points, there was, you know, lines about the inclusion of Indigenous knowledge and funding to support Indigenous knowledge in schools and things like that, because there is a different worldview, and we do have our own ways of healing, and we do have our own systems of everything, you know, and that's not something I grew up knowing, you know, because of the education system that I went through and being disconnected, but it's something I've come to know over the last decade or so, and it's been very empowering for me as an Indigenous person, and it's really, really important because we have a lot to offer as well. And I think through bringing our knowledges forward in a more meaningful way, we can also talk about reconciliation, you know, not just with each other as humans, but reconciliation with the land, you know, reconciliation with the water, and those are important pieces too. And I think just about reconciliation on its own, I feel like those are things that we need. Those are relationships we need to reconcile as much as relationships with each other. And that's in some ways, you know, outside of the Truth and Reconciliation Commission and its mandate and what it was looking at, but I think it's an important piece as well.
You know, Canada is going through a process right now as complex as the conversation that's been happening in South Africa for the last couple of decades, and other places like Rwanda. And Canada is guilty of genocide. And even though right now in the so-called dominant society, they say, oh no, they invoke cultural genocide. The commissioners of the Truth and Reconciliation Commission, they said, oh, Canada's guilty of cultural genocide. But any lawyer will tell you, if you look at the convention, the Geneva Convention on Genocide, it's right in there. It stipulates that any nation state that removes children from their homes, that that act is an act of genocide. And for 100 plus years, you know, Canada stole our children from our families, and they put them in government-funded church-run schools, to quote one of our first prime ministers, Sir John A. Macdonald, to take the Indian out of the child. And they cut our kids' hair, and they beat our children if they spoke their language. And my mom, you know, she went to residential school. All my aunties and uncles went to residential school. I was the first one born in my family that went to public school. And unlike the United States, you know, in the 80s when there was integration, you know, from apartheid, because Canada is an apartheid country, you know, South Africa based its apartheid policy on Canada's Indian reservation system and Indian Act policy, you know. When they integrated our kids into public schools, I was part of that first generation that went to public schools. Only, you know, unlike the United States, when they integrated, you know, black people into schools here, they had the National Guard to take those kids to the school. There was no National Guard when our young Indian kids went to public school in Canada. And so it was a real hard time. You know, I survived through that because my mom raised me tough, you know. But a lot of our kids didn't survive that integration, just like a lot of our kids didn't survive residential school. Thousands of our children died in residential school. To this day, there are hundreds and hundreds of unmarked graves, including some mass graves of our children that died from tuberculosis and other diseases in these basically work camps. That's what these schools were. And so, for me, you know, reconciliation, this process that we've begun, you know, in our country, what it means to me, well, it means a lot of things, and it's very triggering to talk about it, you know. And when we ask our Native people to talk about residential school, we're asking them to relive trauma. And so it's a real difficult conversation to have. And so for me, you know, I guess it means everything. You know, we have to get it right, because the whole thing about residential school is it was part of an agenda, a capitalist agenda, you know, because Canada's entire economic base and their economic framework is inextricably linked to the act of marginalizing Indigenous peoples and their collective rights, of dispossessing those Indigenous peoples from their lands, and then institutionalizing them, you know, either in the former residential schools and now in our prison systems, so that corporations can have access to our natural resources. The conversation about truth and reconciliation and the 98 recommendations that the Truth and Reconciliation put out, that the federal government, the current Trudeau government, committed to adopting and implementing, of course they're not, are fundamentally about, you know, ending colonialism in all its neo-colonial manifestations in the here and now. Because colonization hasn't stopped. And, instead of residential schools, now they're taking our kids away through child and family services and putting our kids in non-native homes. you know, or they're putting our kids in prisons, you know. We represent less than 2% of the Canadian population, but we're 27% of the prison population. And in Canada, a Native woman is 600 times more likely to go to prison for a jailable offense than a non-Native woman, and they are the fastest rising prison demographic. And so, you know, I'm kind of rambling here and I want to get to the rest of the panel, but to me, this is just the ongoing conversation that we need to have to get to a place of liberation, you know, from doing harm to each other. You know, we shouldn't be having, and I think it fundamentally it's a conversation about the radical redistribution of wealth and land in our country, because it's all about the land, you know. And these genocidal policies that our federal government enacted in the interest of extractivism, you know, we've got to talk about our economic paradigm, because that's what it was all about, okay? So I'll leave it at that for now.
Eklanete, ta Eriel Deranger Houché Masicho. My name is Eriel Deranger, and I'm with the Athabasca-Chipewyan First Nation. And like Clayton, I am also first generation not to go to residential school. My father's entire family went to residential school, and my father not only went to residential school, which is something that's not a part of the apology, and I don't think it's actually very well represented within Truth and Reconciliation, which is the tuberculosis hospitals and the experimentation that they did on children. My father spent 3.5 years in a tuberculosis hospital where they experimented on different types of tuberculosis treatments on children. At the time, my father was, he spent from the age of 5 to 7 in the hospital without ever going home. And then when he went home, he was quickly taken into residential schools where he spent an additional 3 years. So his apologies and even his settlement claims that we just heard about, they only account for the 3 years he spent in residential schools, not within the tuberculosis hospitals. And this is not an uncommon story. The residential school stories are absolutely some of the most atrocious stories I've ever heard. And I don't feel the necessity to get into the type of horrific treatment that people went through, but it is something that I grew up knowing, that I grew up hearing the stories of these atrocities and no one else knew them. Because until the Truth and Reconciliation process started, the history and the trauma of Indigenous peoples was an elective. We are an elective. You choose to learn about Indigenous peoples, and it is not something that was a part of the collective history of Canada. The occupied state of Canada, our history was an elective. And so Truth and Reconciliation to me is a part of bringing our truths to the front and to have a way to integrate those truths, not just into the history, but into the collective consciousness of our societies. And it's a critical, it plays a critical role in that. But at the same time, I have a lot of caution when it comes to Truth and Reconciliation, because I don't want it to be a tool that we utilize as a way to absolve those that inflicted this trauma, intergenerational trauma onto people, as a way to absolve themselves of this guilt. And I feel that sometimes it is really enacted in that sort of colonial, patriarchal, and Catholic process of going and, you know, admitting your sins and giving your Hail 10 Marys, and suddenly you're absolved and we're all happy and holding hands and walking down the streets. Because if we saw what happened in Africa with Truth and Reconciliation, is it set up a process of decolonization of African states. Why is Canada not talking about the decolonization of Canada? If they are truthful about Truth and Reconciliation, we would be talking about decolonization. And then when that's when it comes to where, as non-Native and Native people alike, what does this mean? It means we need to be talking about colonization. It means we need to be talking about a process of decolonization and a redistribution of power and wealth and land and all of those things that come along with decolonization. Otherwise, Truth and Reconciliation is just going to fall flat. Thank you. Masicho.
Yeah. Tanse Guakia, Nia Melina Miawap and Laboucan Massimo Nia Nihiao Kinaskumtanawao. My name is Melina Laboucan Massimo, and I'm a member of the Laboucan Cree First Nation, which is in the northern Alberta in the Tar Sands region. And truth and reconciliation to me, is kind of two sides of one coin, because I feel like, yes, we're talking about the truth of a history of a very young country in which most Canadians do not know their own history. So I think that's important for them to know the truth of their own history. But similar to what, you know, the other panelists have been saying, is how do we get over grievances that are still ongoing within Canada? So, you know, I feel like for a lot of truth and reconciliation, that this is like a new thing for Canadians where they're relearning their own history. But for, as Eriel said, we have known from a very young age, knew about the residential schools and had to come to terms with the violence that was inflicted upon my family from a very young age. And it was actually really traumatizing to learn about what happened to my dad, what happened to my aunts, what happened to my uncles. And every single family member and all family members that are Indigenous have these horrible atrocities that have been inflicted upon their family members. And, you know, so there's the trauma of learning, but there's the trauma that's living within our families, and that's been passed down from generation to generation. And so, you know, we had family members that, for me, luckily, they were able to come home in the summer, but there's family members that were taken from the age of 5 until the age of 18, and then never went back to their home families because they were so estranged from their family, their culture, and their language, and their own parents. So there's, you know, there's complete broken linkages in our collective history. And for my family, luckily, my family was able to come home for 2 months out of the whole year. So my aunts and uncles were able to come home, and so we were actually able to keep our language, and because a lot of people lost their language, and my family was able to, you know, to keep Cree because my grandparents didn't speak English, so my family would come home and they would like know the Cree and they would relearn it, so it's been taught, passed down. And my dad was actually the last person in our, you know, in that age group, so he's the youngest. And so by the time my aunts and uncles were older, they told my grandparents how horrific these schools were, where they were being starved, where they were being beaten, where they were being, you know, they wouldn't talk about the rape, but they were, you know, telling these horrible stories. And of course, my dad, as the youngest, was hidden from the Indian agent that would come into our community every fall and take the children. And so my dad, you know, my Muslim would tell him, my grandfather would say, okay, like, we're going to go to the trap line. And my dad would be like, okay, great. You know, he's a little 4-year-old. And they would go to the trap line. They would hide in the bush because another thing important to understand, if these parents didn't give up their children, they were jailed. So I think there's these things where a lot of the history isn't, you know, through the Indian Act, is that they were jailed. We weren't allowed the right to vote till 1960. We weren't allowed to gather in groups of more than 3 and attain a legal counsel. So there was a lot of stipulations. We had to have a land pass to leave our traditional territory, or the reserve land, not even be able to go into our traditional territory to provide a lot of food for our family. So that's why the ration system started coming in, creating dependencies in our communities. So my dad was taken out into the bush. He would come back home, and there would be no children left, just him by himself. You know, and so he'd go through these really lonely periods in his childhood with no children to play with. And so he grew up with the elders, and, you know, he was taught in a traditional sense of, you know, being able to maintain the language and the stories. But as an older person, he became, you know, dependent on the alcoholism that would, because he was so hurt by what was happening. And then, you know, when he went to day school, and by the age of 10, he was beaten for, because he couldn't speak English. So he was beaten for only knowing Cree. So there is like all these horrible stories that a lot of us have in our family that, you know, as a young person, you know, for me, like, that was something I had to come to terms with, of like kind of reliving that trauma of learning all the horrible stories and stories that from other people outside of our family that I can't even repeat because they're so horrific of what happened to them as children. And so for me, truth and reconciliation is kind of, you know, it's like a bitter, sad thing because we're talking about trauma, reliving trauma. Our elders had to, you know, it was like opening up this crazy Pandora's box of woundedness and then, you know, open it up, share it for the world so Canadians can understand their own history and now go on and just pretend that you're like, you know, living your life. Are you healed now? Do you feel better? I don't know how that actually, I think it's actually more beneficial for Canadians than Indigenous peoples for the truth and reconciliation, to be quite honest. So I feel mixed about it. And like Eriel said, the absolution, some people are like, well, we've done the TRC now, so everything, you know, we're done and everything's okay. It's actually a first step to a very long step, a very long process that I think a lot of Canadian people don't necessarily understand. Some do. But that's, you know, slowly changing. We have to start the dialogue. But there's, you know, it's a double-edged sword. So I don't want to kind of say like, yay, truth and reconciliation, it's amazing. It's not. But it's, you know, it's needed. It's a needed step in this long healing process of decolonization, which needs to happen. Hi.
How about you? Tere indeshin ka shaka nashi mang mina wa jabuwe kwa indeshin ka sanishinabe mang makwan zutem kajitinga dunjaba. My name is Tara Houska. I'm from Kuching First Nation. I'm Bear Clan, and I was born under the maple sapping moon. my perspective is a little different, I think, than the most folks on this panel, simply because I was born on the other side of this invisible border that was put in place that we now acknowledge as the United States and Canada. So my family, most of them are actually Canadian. You know, they're from Kuching First Nation and scattered throughout Ontario. But myself, I was born on the U.S. side. And to me, truth and reconciliation is echoes of hurt and seeing invisible scars that people carry through generations. So there was a period of time where this Truth and Reconciliation Commission was happening. And my longtime language and cultural teacher was going through this process. You know, as we were still meeting with our, you know, our awesome little band of our drum circle and our teaching circle and our language circle, and he was going through this process. And it reached a point where the pulling up of these memories and sorting through the incredible atrocities and hurt that happened in residential schools, it left him in a place where he actually had to withdraw and just only spend time with himself for a whole year. And that was something I had never seen before. But the trauma is so real, and it's something that something like a commission can't possibly fix. You can't just say, I'm sorry, and then it's all good. You can't expect that something like that, the theft of children, the theft of language and culture, and, you know, the murdering of children, the knowledge of, that there are mass graves next to schoolhouses, that can't be fixed and solved in a generation. It can't be solved in two generations, and you see echoes of that hurt going from each generation to the next. And then, you know, I saw that with my own family, who is also, you know, some of them live on the U.S. side, and, you know, I observed my grandmother and all of her brothers and sisters who had all gone to residential school, who do not have their language any longer. And knowing that just one went out and brought it back. And seeing the incredible fear they kind of have for Catholicism, for organized religion, because of the intertwining of those two things in residential school. And then in my capacity as an attorney, working with the Indian Child Welfare Act and working with families who were being torn apart and using, as Clayton mentioned, now it's Child Protective Services. Those are the new Indian agents. Those are the folks who don't understand how an Indian family works. They don't understand Native relationships, and that it's not a, you know, it's not always this traditional mother and father setting. You're raised by your community, and just a complete failure to understand that, and also a failure to understand the past wrongs, that things like poverty and things like alcoholism and substance abuse are all kind of part of and symptoms of this incredible wrong that was done. And on the U.S. side, I will say, you know, there is no truth in reconciliation. There is no truth. There are only four. So one thing I always like to point out to people, especially on this side of the border, is that we teach our children from a very, very young age the absolute wrong, untruth about Indigenous people. Truth and reconciliation on this side of the border is shame. Indigenous people are a shameful chapter and a shameful reminder of the United States treatment and the United States Foundation, which is founded on genocide. It's founded on slavery. It's founded on all these principles. And there was, you know, the boarding school era that happened, the forceful ripping apart from children, from families, the time in which the actual federal policy was to kill the Indian and save the man. And then there was the adoption scoop era. I mean, these are all government-sanctioned efforts to forcefully assimilate and Americanize Indigenous people. To take away and just put them into the mix with everybody else and just wipe out the culture, wipe out the memory of what America is really founded on. And so, you know, I think it's shameful, but what I was trying to get to is, you know, this concept of teaching our children from a very young age. There's only four states in this entire country, in the 50 states in the United States, four states that even mention boarding schools. That's what our children are learning from a very young age. Of the schools that are, you know, 87% of references to Native Americans are pre-1900s. After that, there's nothing. There is no boarding school era. There is no adoption scoop. There is no treaties. There is no violations of treaties. It is just that. There's this really kind of, you know, there's manifest destiny, and then the Indians just kind of die out, and that's what people learn. So I think, you know, as much as truth and reconciliation is not a solution, it's not the solution, it doesn't just make things all better. At the same time, I do also think that at least acknowledging the truth and teaching the truth to our children is critical. My hope is that America and the United States and Canada both can acknowledge and look at their relationship with Indigenous people and make real substantive change. Miigwech.
You know, the TRC was a really messy process, and reconciliation is a very messy process. And, you know, when we do our work in the environmental justice movement, we tend to end up working with a lot of frontline Native communities. And when we bring them to direct actions or to lobby in Washington, D.C., or where, you know, to go hit a shareholder meeting of some kind of oil company, me and my crew, we take great care in, you know, making sure that our delegates have a nice hotel room, maybe an Airbnb where they can all stay together and share meals. We make sure that they're well taken care of, because we're asking them to relive their trauma when they confront corporations or the government or whatever, because, you know, they're telling their story. And so the TRC was a really intense process. And I think the commissioners and those supporting them, certainly Justice Sinclair, did a lot to take care of people, but, you know, the blunt approach of the federal government, you know, throughout this process, the establishment of the criteria for Indian residential school survivors to apply for compensation under the compensation index of the Truth and Reconciliation Commission, these were horrific processes. You know, it almost killed my mom. And my mom almost got killed by residential school. And she spent her whole life trying to heal from it. And then when she went to the, you know, and told her story and went into the court process to get her settlement, you know, they denied her. Because they couldn't, you know, she had to tell all the stories about the sexual and physical abuses and Because of a clerical error of the federal government, her and thousands of other residential school applicants were denied their settlements because the Catholic Church was let off the hook because of a clerical error of the settler colonial state of Canada. And there are a million instances of injustice like this throughout the process that, quite honestly, resulted in a lot of our residential school survivors dying because the trauma was too much to bear. And they committed suicide, or they, you know, drank themselves to death, or they died from autoimmune deficiency diseases, or all of these things that come from trauma and stress.
I don't think you can talk to like a single first generation, not in residential school person without that being a similar story. You know, my father got one of the first lump settlements where it's like if you signed up and you they could prove that you went to residential school for like, you know, X amount of years and you got like, I think it was X amount of money for each year you went to residential school before you had to actually talk about the trauma. And my dad went through the same process as Clayton's mom where he went and he went through the testimony and all this stuff and there was some sort of clerical error and my dad never received the big one. He received like the $8,000 or something that they gave at the beginning of the process. And he's like, and I don't know why. And something to know is my dad is a transient. My dad has multiple personality disorder. And that is an effect of residential schools and the trauma that he experienced there and in the tuberculosis hospitals. And one of the things, when the apology came out in 2007, I was on a youth council and I was asked to be a part of a CBC town hall where they were talking to a bunch of youth about what the apology meant to them. And I went to that and I was like, I was invited and I was like, you know, I don't really have a lot of nice things to say because I actually think this apology is a piece of crap because it's an apology to residential school survivors. It's not an apology to the tuberculosis hospital survivors. It's not an apology to me as a first generation, not in residential school survivor. And it's not an apology to all the people that died before that. And to talk about intergenerational trauma, it's not just about genetically, it's in our blood. We actually experienced real trauma that is a byproduct of what happened to residential school survivors. One out of 50% of Native people have experienced some form of sexual abuse or sexual violence. That is a product of residential schools. That is because most of these people that went to residential schools were raped and sexually assaulted and molested by the people that ran these schools. And there were no systems in place to heal from that trauma. And therefore, when those people had children, they ended up inflicting these same types of abuses onto their children. And this is, they don't talk, there was no apology to the people that experienced sexual abuse. I am a sexual abuse survivor from a person who went through residential schools. And that story is just all too common. And that is also why our children are being taken out of homes because of sexual abuse. But there is no system put into place to help those parents that experience sexual abuse to heal from that trauma. Instead, we are punishing them even further by taking away their children. We don't talk about the people that died before this apology, and there is no compensation for that. My stepfather, he also was in a tuberculosis hospital where he experienced an immense amount of trauma and sexual abuse and physical violence and cultural violence. And he died of a stroke that could have been prevented had he had surgery, but he was so traumatized he could not step foot into a hospital and he died. There is no compensation for that. There is no compensation for the abuse that I experienced. There is no compensation for the intergenerational trauma that we experienced. There's no compensation for the devaluation of Indigenous women and Indigenous peoples. There was no apology for that. There was apology for something that they feel like they did in the past, but they aren't doing now. But it's happening every single day. Every single day, this intergenerational trauma continues to exist. So my experiences with Truth and Reconciliation is that it falls flat. It doesn't address the systemic problems that continue to exist. There's no one asking me about my trauma. There is no one apologizing to me. the Truth and Reconciliation Commission's not coming to me or to Clayton or Melina. It's just, I feel that it's a broken system. And it's not addressing the so many things that we have to deal with every day as an Indigenous woman in this country. And I really, like, and the violence that we experience on a daily basis, it's not being addressed within this process at all.
I think another thing that is important to discuss is the byproduct of families being broken apart and people leaving their communities because they weren't safe. Was a lot of women have left communities because they didn't, you know, they were either looking for work or they were looking to go to school. So this is another kind of byproduct of colonial and government policy, where Indigenous women have been leaving our communities, you know, over the past at least 3 decades, and they leave to go find work and, you know, go get jobs and schooling. And this is, you know, this isn't just 30 years ago. This is like 3 years ago, where my sister went to school and she went to Toronto to finish her degree in college, and she was found dead in Toronto.
And this is something the government refused to admit. And they finally admitted this past year, actually, the Minister of the Status of Women in the federal government in Canada admitted that up to actually 4,000 women, of Indigenous women in Canada, are murdered or missing. And so at first the government didn't want to admit this. It's 500 women. Oh no, okay, it's 1,200 women. And now the fact that the new federal government is admitting that it's now up to 4,000 women. So, you know, people are really shocked in Canada that Indigenous women are being murdered and missing. But for us as Indigenous people, it's not a shocking thing. I really believe in the power of healing. And I think that, you know, that's what needs to happen. I think what I've seen, though, what I've witnessed and experienced myself, is that the healing is on the onus of the people, and that there isn't the support for the people that there should be or needs to be from colonial and genocidal policies, which is really unfortunate. Say, for example, to finish the story of my dad, who was hidden from residential school, but then went to day school, and then from there was beaten for speaking his language and everything else that went along in those schools. He, you know, as in my younger age, he was, like I said, was really every fall, because he had that such a sense of loneliness. He didn't know why he would go into a cycle of binging and, you know, into his alcoholism. So he would, I don't really remember seeing him in a lot of the fall time. I'd always see him in the spring and summer growing up, until he finally went and actually did the healing and uncovered that, you know, like coming to terms with, I think, the abuse, but also coming to terms of why the cycles are, you know, when we create these coping mechanisms, why are we creating these coping mechanisms and what are they? And for him, he realized it was because every fall, he had such a deep-seated sense of loneliness that he utilized, you know, like you said, the coping of alcoholism. And so for him, you know, he's been now sober for almost 2 decades and, you know, is the chief of our nation. So I believe in the power of healing. And I believe that, you know, people can heal from these things, but I feel like, you know, the onus is a lot of times on us. So I've done a lot of my healing outside. It's in ceremony and all of the other things that we can access through our culture. But, you know, a lot of times it's like similar to the point that Clay made at the beginning, is that the ongoing grievances continue through neo-colonialism, and yet the ongoing and raping and pillaging of our lands and, you know, and those resources. So therefore, how can we practice ceremony on our lands if they're being destroyed? So it's all kind of tied up in this interwoven play that's happening right now, where, you know, for us, we don't go to church, we don't go to temple, we go and pray on the land. And when it's being destroyed in the tar sands where Eriel and I are from, how can we access all of those healing mechanisms that our communities and our cultures have given us? Sometimes it makes it very difficult to do that proper type of healing. So.
I mean, let's be real. The Truth and Reconciliation process is a process that was created and sanctioned by the colonial government. So it's wrought with really severe limitations that serve them more than serve us. We just got to be real about that. And even though we had amazing people like Justice Minister Sinclair and other amazing elders and cultural and ceremonial people that were a part of the Truth and Reconciliation process and leading it and guiding it, it was a system and a process created for the government to find some sort of absolution for what they had done. And I think that when it comes to cultural ceremony, getting back to that comment that Melina and Clayton made about the land, it's like sometimes it can be like a triggering and a re-trauma to go out to your land to try and heal. Because you go out there and you realize how much it's being compromised still. And you see the beauty of it and you see how it's all being taken away. And how those very places and the process of truth and reconciliation for the harm that's done in residential schools, that was just an extension of the harm that's been done to our people for multiple generations and centuries. And I was out in my territory just a few weeks ago at a moose camp with young people, and it was beautiful, and it was healing for me. But as I was, you know, boating back to town on the lake, I was suddenly filled with sadness. Because every single day, that lake is compromised by more contamination from the development of tar sands. Every day, those river systems are being withdrawn from oil and gas development, logging efforts, mega hydro dams. Every day, those things are disappearing. And there's not a truth and reconciliation for the land. There's not a truth and reconciliation for the ongoing appropriation of our lands and territories, our medicine, and our culture and our identities that are attached to those spaces. And there is direct linkages to the appropriation of lands and territory and the cultural and direct genocide of Indigenous peoples, and linkages to the violence against women that Melina has experienced in her family and that all of us have been touched by. It's all a holistic circle of violence perpetuated by the colonial state. And so what could have been done differently in Truth and Reconciliation is a recognition that it was not just residential schools, that it was a system of oppression and systems of oppression of capitalism, patriarchy, colonialism that has allowed these types of things to happen. Residential school is a symptom of those things, not the only thing. It is not what caused the problems in our community. And so I think that if I was able to, you know, go back and say, let's start this process all over again, there would be a truth and reconciliation for the appropriation and the stealing of our lands and territories. There would be a reconciliation for the devaluing of women and matriarchal societies. There would be a truth and reconciliation for everyone and what had happened to our communities. And I think that is the big misstep that happened. It doesn't matter how many great people we had at the helm of this process. It was essentially developed for the state.
I mean, like, that's a no-brainer, yeah. I mean, there needs to be a truth and reconciliation process here in the United States. There's been great, great discourse and conversations and debate, you know, on the question of reparations for African Americans and relationship to, you know, stolen labor to build this country, you know. And I think that there needs to be just as much conversation on what that slave labor was used in terms of the land, the stolen land it was used on. And I think that, you know, the United States can do better. You know, all the challenges of the Truth and Reconciliation process in Canada, that's not to say that we don't have our own process. You know, we've been doing our own work in our communities and building power, base building, you know, expanding our political base of resistance to protect our water, to protect our land, to protect our treaty rights, our inherent rights, and to, you know, somehow throughout all of this stuff, continue to uplift and uphold our sacred responsibilities to the original instructions Creator gave us when Creator put us in the place where we call home. And we will continue to protect that long after Canada and the United States are not around. We will be, you know. And hopefully, you know, whoever your great-great-great-great-grandkids are right there beside ours, too. Living in a good way, having reconciled all of this craziness. So, yeah.
I think that a country should be judged by how it treats its most vulnerable citizens. Yeah. And the United States and Canada have a lot to answer for. They have a lot to answer for as we continue and as this still happens to Indigenous people. You know, it's these rights, the treatment of human beings and equality should matter to us all. It should be a shame to U.S. citizens that the federal government engages in these activities. It should be a shame that we don't teach our children these things, that we don't teach our young minds that maybe part of the reason why reservations, which are remnants, you know, the pieces of land that the United States didn't want, maybe that's why reservations have like such bad poverty rates. Maybe that's why economic development isn't even a possibility there. You know, if we knew about these things, maybe we would learn about treaty rights. We would learn that, oh, it's 2016 and we're still openly violating these treaties that have been broken almost as soon as they were signed, but we're still doing it today. I think that, you know, if we even just the most basic part would just be education. If we even just mention these things, that would do so much for creating a narrative in which the truth is acknowledged, in which Indigenous people actually have a voice in the conversation, in which Indigenous people continue to exist in the modern narrative. You know, every single person that's up here is the embodiment of resilience. This is resilience. And so to anyone that says, you know, get over it, you guys are being thin-skinned, I'm going to go ahead and say I think Indigenous people are some of the most resilient people you could possibly come across. And so, yeah, I mean, in short, I think, yes, the United States should do better, and it can do a hell of a lot better. And it could start by just maybe stopping some of the things it's currently doing and acknowledge past wrongs. Miigwech. You know, another way to get involved, aside from teaching everyone and anyone who will listen to you, because that should be a task that each and every one of us has, is to educate those around us and tell the truth. And change the narrative. We need to change the narrative. Is to make sure that we have elected officials who actually even mention Native Americans. These folks, the federal government is the one that has a relationship with tribes. It's a nation-to-nation relationship. We should be electing people who actually know what treaties are, who know what Indigenous people are, who are willing to fund Indigenous budgets. I mean, these are basic services like healthcare, like schools, like suicide prevention, like all of these really, really necessary services that were guaranteed by treaty, I would like to add, that were negotiated and, you know, oftentimes on one side actually forcefully negotiated. But there's still things that the federal government agreed to that's not fulfilling. It's something that I think it's important to educate, but also to participate in the process. Make sure you're voting in elected officials that know these things, hold them accountable, hold our judiciary accountable, and, you know, advocate from the grassroots up. That's how real change is made, right? Well.